If UV is so important, and the United States helped develop and commercialize it, then why aren't we making these UV machines in the United States? In 2001, ASML paid $1.6 billion to acquire San Jose-based Silicon Valley Group, or SVG. SVG was the last major American lithography company. The decline and fall of the American lithography industry holds a thoughtful lesson for policymakers. Today's video is a deep dive into this significant moment in semiconductor history. Now, I'm not going to give you a new update on UV or lithography here. You can watch a bunch of other videos about it. But I would like to give a special thanks to Craig Addison. He did a great episode of his Chip Warriors podcast about America's lithography industry. Great story, and I recommend it so much. Our story picks up a little bit in the second half of that. Once upon a time, two big American companies, GCA and PerkinElmer, dominated the industry. GCA was once an American giant with $300 million of revenue in 1984, but the machine suffered spotty quality, frequently breaking down, which shut down expensive manufacturing lines and angered plant managers. When customer Toshiba suggested a few ways to improve, GCA waved them off, essentially saying, "Buy what we build and don't bother us." This arrogance cost GCA a great deal when Toshiba turned to Nikon. Nikon and Canon purchased GCA's machines, modified them, and made them work better. After Nikon and Canon broke through in 1984, GCA and PerkinElmer struggled. GCA's revenue fell off a cliff, collapsing 50% in 1985. The company lost $100 million over 2 years and cut 70% of their payroll. They had no legal recourse. Apparently, GCA's founder, Milton Greenberg, never even patented his device. And even if they had, the Japanese lithography machines had sufficiently changed enough from the originals. PerkinElmer was the junior company of the two, with about 11% of the market in 1989. That same year, GCA had about 13%, Nikon, the market leader, had 30%, and Canon 15%. PerkinElmer's chip-making unit struggled to stay profitable. In the year ended in July 1988, they produced just $3 million in profit on $200 million of sales. The reality of it is that, for all the sweet and precious words spoken by pundits and politicians, lithography is not a very good business. You have to spend hundreds of millions of dollars in upgrades to keep up with the competition. Lithography companies need to spend about 12 to 25% of their revenue on R&D and 10 to 15% on capital investments. These are up to twice the amount of other semiconductor equipment companies. The customers are very demanding and quite particular about their machine specs, and these machines barely work. They break down all the time, so servicing is critical. And the semiconductor industry, particularly the memory industry, is extremely cyclical. You might be up 30% 1 year and down 30% the next. This really sucks because there are long lead times between orders and getting paid, sometimes as much as 2 years. So a customer might put in an order when times are good, and then suddenly cancel when times get hard. Then you are in for a bad time. In such an industry, the customers really matter. TSMC helped get ASML off the ground by buying their tools over the Japanese incumbents. And IBM helped save PerkinElmer's lithography division. In late 1989, news came out that Nikon was exploring an acquisition of PerkinElmer's lithography business. Nikon denied the talks, but PerkinElmer did want out. Policymakers soon fretted over the idea of American-made lithography technology potentially falling into Japanese hands. So did IBM, PerkinElmer's single largest customer. They were concerned about being forced to use Japanese lithography technology. Japanese companies were then some of their biggest competitors. So someone had to be found in order to take over from PerkinElmer. But the key point was more than just finding a buyer. It wouldn't be too expensive. No, it was more about finding someone who can afford the skyrocketing capital investment costs of producing better lithography equipment. IBM had this new, more productive lithography technology, It would eventually become the step-and-scan machine, or the stepper. They gave it to PerkinElmer to commercialize. But who can afford spending millions more dollars to finish the stepper? In comes Silicon Valley Group, SVG. SVG started off as a small equipment maker. They first made edge grinders for wafers and then expanded into wafer coating equipment. They then appointed a new CEO named Papkin Derterossian, a Syrian-American who first came to the States in the 1950s. Derterossian decided that the company had to expand to stay competitive as the big guys shrank their supplier base. So he bought Thermco, one of the leading makers of vertical furnaces for thermal oxidation. Thermal oxidation is a way to apply an oxide onto something like a silicon wafer using heat and oxygen. He then cross-sold SVG products through Thermco's very established user network. This eventually helped grow the company and bring it to public prominence, though they were still very small, about $120 million market cap at the time. Terassian wanted to take over PerkinElmer's lithography business and worked hard to overcome skeptical feelings from both IBM and PerkinElmer, lobbying to PerkinElmer chairman Horace G. McDonnell. He eventually convinced them. So in the end, they paid just $20 million for a big stake to create SVG Lithography. The new SVGL also accepted minor equity investments from IBM and PerkinElmer. SVG Lithography took the nascent IBM lithography technology and, with help from Semitech, eventually produced the Microscan 2, a DUV stepper machine. Meanwhile, in 1988, GCA was sold to General Signal Corporation for about $80 million. General Signal was a grab-bag technology conglomerate of random stuff. Some of GCA's siblings included telecom gear and signal boxes. But thanks to ample amounts of financial support from the US government, GCA improved their tools' reliability and produced a machine more technologically advanced than the Japanese. It is estimated that Semitech infused some $60 to $80 million into GCA in the 5 years after 1988. Support came in the form of investment, direct purchases of GCA equipment for testing and feedback, and some government arm twisting. In 1990, Semitech started pushing its members to try GCA's upgraded equipment. The companies resisted, but Semitech insisted, saying that lithography was 50% of Moore's Law and that Japan would never give America its best equipment. As it turns out, the new equipment was quite good. Customers acknowledged the vastly improved quality. GCA's XLS series of steppers were even said to be world-class. The tools were central to achieving the upcoming 350-nanometer node. In 1992, Digital Equipment Corporation chose GCA tools over those from Canon and Nikon for their next line of chips. Larry Thompson, head of lithography at Bell Labs, said, "From our viewpoint, the performance of GCA's latest DUV stepper, the XLS7800-31, indicates that GCA is at least 12 months ahead of the competition." Brian Clark from Motorola added, "GCA has made great strides in the last few years. It will be a travesty if it doesn't find a buyer." Yet the XLS was too little too late, and an 18-month delay in 1990 in producing I-line lithography equipment nicks their last chance to take market share. By 1992, the once mighty GCA had just 2% of the market. And they still lost money, about $4 million a quarter in the early 1990s. General Signal eventually tired of these losses. Their CEO wanted to focus on businesses with returns on equity over 20%. So in early 1993, he announced that General Signal would attempt to sell several of GCA's semiconductor equipment units. Yet again, there was another political huff, more grandstanding by people about the national security value of an American lithography industry, but no one wanted to back that talk with money. Semitech scrambled to find another suitor and arrange another shotgun marriage. Foreigners feared political blowback, though one of the Korean chaebol did kick the tires a bit. Domestic players did not really take to the idea. A merger with Applied Materials might have been interesting, but for whatever reason they turned it down. And in terms of customers, IBM had arranged the marriage between PerkinElmer and SVG, but there was no similar player for GCA. And as for government, Semitek said that they would not involve themselves in business rescues. They had already spent the majority of their $100 million annual budgets on lithography development. In the end, General Signal sold off bits and pieces of GCA, like the lens and service businesses, but there was no saving the large wafer stepper manufacturing facilities in Massachusetts. It closed down in May 1993, with 120 jobs lost. With this, SVG became the last American lithography company. Over the next few years, SVG continued developing its DUV machinery. The political environment surrounding Japan loosened up as America's semiconductor comeback in the early 1990s played itself out. Throughout the decade, SVG was deeply involved in next-generation lithography development. As early as 1994, SVG was investigating new forms of ultraviolet light lithography, taking some $30 million from Semitek in the form of a direct investment to do so. In 1996, Intel, AMD, Motorola, and the other American semiconductor companies signed agreements with the Department of Energy to found EUV LLC. This strange joint venture would carry out EUV's development over the next 3 to 4 years. In late 1997, SVG signed an agreement with EUV LLC. They were the first American lithography maker to enter the partnership. A year later, ASML and a subsidiary of the American semiconductor manufacturer, Ultratech Stepper, joined as well. Ultratech had been one of GCA's siblings at General Signal. They produced a different type of lithography machine, 1X lithography, for specific, unconventional purposes. Then SVG took their eye off the ball. In the late 1990s, the semiconductor industry transitioned from 248-nanometer krypton fluoride DUV steppers to 193-nanometer argon fluoride DUV. In September 1998, ASML announced the move to 193 with the PAS550-900. The transition required great amounts of materials engineering by Carl Zeiss to produce a unique lens system made from calcium fluoride and fused silica. In February 1999, SVG also announced the move to 193 nanometers with the Microscan 193. They also announced a 157 nanometer project thanks to additional equity funding from Intel. But the Microscan 193 suffered massive problems and repeated delays. In August 1999, SVG reported that customers had canceled $53 million worth of 193 nanometer orders. It was a devastating blow. Intel took steps to shore up confidence in SVG. In December 1999, the CPU giant announced that it would purchase $100 million worth of 193-nanometer DUV equipment from SVG. But the delays dragged on, forcing Intel to delay the rollout of their 130-nanometer node. The 193-nanometer debacle sparked rumors of trouble at SVG. In terms of 1999 sales, SVG was a distant fourth place, generating just $270 million in sales compared to ASML's $1.12 billion. S.G. Cowan estimated that after the August 1999 cancellations, Intel had 90% of SVG's 193-nanometer DUV machine orders. SVG's advanced lithography program was basically Intel and nothing else. It was becoming increasingly clear that SVG could not compete. And looking ahead to 157 nanometers or even EUV, SVG simply did not have the money to bring the device to fruition. Tourassian told people that it was going to take $1 billion to bring EUV to the fab floor. He had no idea how SVG was going to get this money. In actuality, EUV would take far more. These concerns only intensified as the dot-com bubble burst in the 1999-2000 period, taking down the semiconductor and semiconductor manufacturing equipment markets with them. On October 2, 2000, ASML and SVG announced the merger. ASML would acquire SVG for $1.6 billion in an all-stock acquisition. The deal would make ASML the largest lithography company in the industry. Behind the scenes, SVG's struggles with 193 nanometers alarmed Intel, their biggest customer. Intel sourced from two lithography makers, Nikon and SVG, and they wanted to keep it that way. If SVG were to go down, it not only constricted the supplier base, but also risks disaster when it came to next-generation lithography. ASML had successfully shipped 193 nanometers and was keen to have Intel as a customer, but if Intel left, SVG would certainly collapse. So the best way to handle things would be a merger. The two companies can combine their R&D spend and develop UV together. The big problem, however, was the politics. SVG was America's last lithography maker. Semitec and the US government put millions of dollars of investment into the company. ASML was a Dutch company. The US and the Netherlands are friendly, but this would be a big export issue. Furthermore, one of SVG's big subsidiaries was Tinsley Labs, the optics system manufacturer that SVG acquired in 1997. They were leading the effort to produce the 157 and EUV optics systems. The issue was that Tinsley had once been a defense contractor producing optics for spy satellites in the 1990s. But SVG claimed that there currently was no business being done with the Pentagon. Acquisitions by foreign companies need to be approved by CFIUS, the Committee on Foreign Investment in the United States. At first, approval seemed a slam dunk. The panel at the time was seen as a rubber stamp. But near the end of the 30-day review period, a group of congressmen asked federal officials to do a second look. It is likely that this interruption came at the behest of Ultratech, the other American lithography system integrator within the EUV LLC consortium. They had circulated around Congress 650 copies of a videotape titled "Why the Sale of SVG Co. is Bad for the United States." In the tape, they talked mostly about Tinsley Labs and national security, but they also voiced concerns about leaving ASML with a monopoly on next-generation lithography machines, saying that they would raise prices on vendors. They also speculated that ASML would give preference to European semiconductor makers over American ones, and that ASML might send EUV technology to quote-unquote enemies like China and Russia. But Intel refused to be dissuaded. They steadfastly insisted upon the acquisition. Their CEO, Craig Barrett, met with President Bush and Vice President Cheney to lobby for the deal. Barrett said, "Without the merger, the development path to the new tools in the United States will be delayed, and in time, other global competitors of SVG will seize the advantage." This is a reference to Japan's own EUV efforts, then ramping up, which ASML and America were able to fend off. Finally, in May 2001, ASML promised that they would search for an American buyer for Tinsley Labs. They replaced the vendor with Carl Zeiss, and things seem to have gone along just fine. ASML also agreed to strictly comply with US export control requirements, and they agreed to keep and invest in certain operations in the United States. A few months after closing the deal, ASML dropped development on SVG's 193-nanometer microscan tool. The tool's ultra-complicated optic system was too slow and apparently was beyond saving. Intel took up the TwinScan, as they probably wanted to in the first place. In 2003, ASML sold SVG's two other businesses, the thermal furnace and track businesses. Within 2 years, ASML basically shut down SVG. They did retain SVG's R&D centers, including ASML Wilton, today their largest R&D hub in the US. Robert Noyce himself said in a congressional hearing that Semitech's legacy would be in large part remembered for how successful it is in saving America's lithography machines. Semitech did a great many things. It is in no little part thanks to them that American companies like Applied Materials, Lam Research, and KLA remain leaders in their fields. But Semitech could not save the American lithography industry. Intel, at the very peak of their powers, could not save the American lithography industry. The reasons behind America's lithography failure remain up for debate, but it should be discussed as we enter this new era of government-led industrial policy for semiconductors. What do you think? All right, everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to your channel, sign up for the newsletter, and I'll see you guys next time.